KTVU and Montage and the Community Affairs Department of KTVU is very honored to have with us today in an exclusive interview the Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad, spiritual leader of over 2 million Muslims in America. Good evening, I'm Johnny Barnes-Selvin, and I'd like to start off by thanking Wallace D. Muhammad for taking time out in a very, very busy schedule. He's only here for less than 24 hours to be with us this evening. And I'd like to start right away. Thank you for coming.
Well, we're very pleased to be here.
I can't tell you how delighted I am to have you. I'd like to start right off by asking you how your father in 1930 started the Muslim movement that has grown to be such a vast movement by 1977.
Yes. Well, he was taught by a man called Farhad Muhammad.
Mm-hmm.
And this man introduced himself as a Muslim teacher and later was called Prophet. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad saw him as a manifestation of God,
mm-hmm.
or like Christ, God in the flesh. And with the teachings of Master Farhad, he's called Master Farhad, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was able to understand the problems of the American so-called Negro, as mm-hmm. it was called in those days by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He referred to as a so-called Negroes. He understood that the problem was a need for identity, a need for an identification with some glorious past,
mm-hmm.
A need to have some leadership, black leadership, and someone to, well, push, as he said. He said, our people, because they were pushed by the slave master, they don't understand, they don't recognize that there's anyone over them unless they feel the push. Mm-hmm. So he believed in pushing, and by him being, an industrious man, every morning he would rise very early, he would work all day long until the very late hours of the night, sometime early hours in the morning. And he gave orders and he pushed his people and he insisted upon absolute total obedience.
This is your father.
My father.
Yes.
Right. And you know all the dietary laws and regulations, community regulations, no movies, no drinking, no smoking, and no fornication or adultery, no chasing the girls, that is.
Mm-hmm.
All the other disciplines that he insisted upon really proved to be things that the people he attracted really wanted. They wanted to feel a control on their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew that, and he was successful because of that. He started in 32. He just used the teachings that he got from Master Farhad Muhammad, which was mainly teachings to instill a sense of superiority into the people. And to give them disciplines that they could follow that would take them away from the old habits of laziness, not caring about their appearance. As you know, all the men wore white shirts and ties every day, like
That's
they
right.
were white-collar workers, but they were selling newspapers, and many of them were working on as clean-up men in stores and doing other...
Excuse me. Along with discipline and a sense of one's own value that your
mm-hmm.
father worked very hard to instill in his followers. There is one thing that you said as we were going along. You said that Master Farhad Muhammad came and was interpreted as Allah in man's form.
Mm-hmm.
Now that you're part of the world community of Islam, this is one of the changes that's come about in the past few years. Now that you're part of the world community of Islam, do you still hold to the belief that Allah came in man's form?
No, we don't. I don't completely reject. Mm-hmm. There's something true about it, but I think just the failure on the part of the leader, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, to find the right words,
mm-hmm.
Because he taught me. I grew up under him as his son. And I know what he taught me, it didn't give me the same idea that I get when I read of incarnation, reincarnation, God incarnate, Christ God, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't get that same concept. I didn't get the same belief.
So, in other words, you might have believed that that Master Fard Muhammad was a man who was imbued with the spirit,
yes,
but not necessarily Allah.
No, not a man who was directed somehow helpless to do his own will, you know, an instrument of God. That's the idea, I think.
Okay. There are a number of things that have changed with your taking over the reins, essentially. And before we get into that, I'd like to find out how your father prepared you. From what I understand, you were groomed from the time you were a child to step into this position that you now hold as chief spiritual leader. What kind of education did you have?
Well, there was no special courses put together or written up for me. The thing that prepared me, I believe, was the mystery that was created around me.
What do you mean by that?
Well,
the mystery.
I was told from earliest years that Master Farad Muhammad named me while I was in my mother, mm-hmm, while I was yet in my mother, and that he predicted it would be a boy, and he gave me his name, one of his names that he used, which was Wallace, mm-hmm, D. Muhammad, you know, and that I would follow in my father's footsteps and become a great helper to my father. And my
so
father
before
and mother
you
would,
were born,
that's
the,
right,
myth, the
that's
myth had started. You
that's
were
correct, that's
being
right,
represented.
Right.
Okay.
That's right. And that was told to me over and over again all of my years. And I had other ideas about what I wanted to be, you know.
Mm-hmm.
At one time, I wanted to be an electronic technician. And at other time, I wanted to be a school teacher, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know exactly what I was going to turn out to be. But those things were planted in my mind. And I guess I was rebelling against it.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember in Chicago, I believe in 56 it was, we have a testifying night.
Mm-hmm.
The minister would say, "Is anyone would like to come up and express himself?" So I had a friend, Leroy, I grew up with. He said, "Let me show you how to do it. You're so shy," and I was very shy. So Leroy got up and he spoke, and we were always challenging each other, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So just to show him that he couldn't do something I couldn't do, I got up, and when I got up and faced the people, I began to speak, and before I realized it, the shyness had gone, and I was preaching like a minister.
I see. Did you not have any training in Arabic?
Yes, I did. But
now that's rather unusual.
Others.
You must admit.
No. It wasn't. No, it was. I would say there was really an effort on my father's part to see that his sons got learned, mm-hmm, something about the Arabic language, mm-hmm, and that was Akbar, my youngest brother, and myself. And a couple other brothers, they studied some too. But he did want his youngest sons, Akbar and myself, to learn the Arabic language. But in the class that I graduated from under Professor Jamil Diab was about 19 students.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
So you were preceded by a myth and educated then in the ways of Islam as you grew up.
Mm-hmm.
There are a number of things that your father stated and what the Muslim wants. He said, "We want justice, we want freedom, we want equal membership in society, and we want to establish a separate state or territory on this continent or elsewhere.
Mm-hmm.
We also feel that our former slave masters are obligated to provide land which should be fertile and minerally rich, mm-hmm, and that they should, in fact, for the first 20 or 25 years when this land is being established, support it and,
yes,
help maintain it."
Yes.
Is this still the policy? Is this your policy?
No. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad, felt that he just gave himself to the teachings of Master Farad Muhammad.
Mm-hmm.
And he interpreted those teachings himself.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, you heard the Yaqub story, right? The story of Yaqub.
Would you repeat that?
The scientist. Well, there was a scientist by the name of Yaqub who made the Caucasian race by mating lighter black people together. And as they got a lighter child, they would mate lighter ones with lighter ones until finally a Caucasian race, you know. His plan, Yaqub's plan, caused such an uproar in the society that he belonged to, until the leaders came to him and said, well, can we make some kind of agreement? Is there any way to satisfy you and keep you out of our society?
Mm-hmm.
He said, if you will accept exile, how can we satisfy you? So he said, well, if you give me enough supplies to take care of myself and my followers for 20 years, I will accept to be exiled,
mm-hmm.
you know, and won't give you any trouble. You leave in peace. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad took that to me as being a hint to him from Master Farad that when you make trouble for these people and they don't like you anymore, tell them you accept exile and take care of us for 20 years.
Are you even thinking about exile yourself? Do you think in those terms at all?
No, if I become a wicked person, I would like to exile myself.
But as far as a separate state or separate nation?
The only people who need to be exiled are people who can't live in peace with other people.
All right, then that's a big change there. Another change, and again, I'm just going to go down the list of things that were formally connected with the Bilalian or black Muslim movement is philosophy. The white man is the devil. Quietly, philosophy quietly died out around 1975. And how did that happen? Why did that happen?
And I like the way you put it. I believe you're correctly informed. It quietly died out.
Yes.
Because the Honorable Elijah Muhammad himself was killing it himself.
I see.
In the last few years of his life with us, may peace be upon him, he pleaded to the community almost to accept Caucasians, accept them as people deserving respect from us.
Mm-hmm.
He said, if they can treat you well and respect you, then you have to return that, you know. He had opened up businesses and had created a lot of business associations and relationships with us and Caucasian people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he was all the time telling us at the private meetings of the staff that you have to accept the Caucasian as a man, as a human being, and don't be ignorant.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't be ignorant, because some of the members weren't aware that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was speaking from scriptural terminology when he was calling white people devils, you know.
I see,
And the concepts had to be understood. There was a lot of allegorical and symbolic meanings there that had to be understood. He knew that, but many of his followers didn't, and he chose not to tell them, because if he had told them, they would have perhaps rejected him.
I see.
He said he used these things as attractive bait. At the time, the conditions were there, and his kind of teaching was very attractive, and he wanted the people, so he used it.
I see. So at the moment, today in a mosque, you'd never ever hear that spoken.
Devil?
Yes.
Certainly. We call the white people devils, the black people devils.
Oh, you do?
Yeah. When they act like devils, we call them devils.
Okay, when they act like devils. Well, is the term devil then used more for characteristics
that's
that
right.
you would consider
that's
evil?
Right. That's
whether
right.
they're displayed by a black or a white or an Asian or whatever race. It's the characteristic, the trait,
right.
the act, and not the, not the color.
And not the flesh, right.
Okay. I have so many questions for you. There's one, this past year in Washington, the Hanafi sect held 134 people hostage for 39 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And that was caused from all that we've learned by an internal Muslim conflict. I was wondering what role you played in that. And the other question I have, if any, in trying to facilitate and end that siege, facilitate the ending of the siege. And along with that, what power do you have over sects like the Hanafi? Exactly how far does your power extend?
Well,
a lot of questions.
Well, I don't think I have any power over the Hanafis.
Mm-hmm. And why
but
is that?
They respect us as Muslims, and we respect them as Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
I felt obligated to do whatever I could to protect the hostages if there was any opportunity for me to do that. And I went to Washington during that siege. Mm-hmm. And I made an attempt to see the mayor, but I accepted that the mayor and the police department, they were in charge of what was going on there. And I was just there to taking a long shot that my presence, they might desire my presence. So I'm here. In case they need me, I don't have to be called from Chicago.
Right.
I'm right here, you know. I felt obligated because the Hanafis had charged the Nation of Islam with the massacre of the leaders, Mr. Khalifa's family as, mm-hmm. as children. And there were persons who went in the names of the community. They used the X, you know,
mm-hmm.
and they were identified as members of our community. I don't have any knowledge that those persons were really members. I don't know whether they just used those names to cover up something or not. And then they could have been fanatical members, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt obligated to do something, at least not only for the hostages, but also for the Hanafis. I called Mr. Khalifa and I told him that I've heard how he felt and I want him to know that my sympathies had always been with him and his family.
I see.
Yeah.
I see. So that would have helped to facilitate somewhat.
Well, I hope it did, and I believe it helped some.
Well, having you there, I think, was an important thing, as long as they realized that you were there. Are there sects that violently disagree with the Nation of Islam, the Black Muslim movement, joining the world community of Islam?
I don't know of any.
You don't know of any?
I don't know of any, no.
All right. Is the Nation of Islam, the 2 million or so Muslims in this country, are they in a fairly together as far as philosophy, theology is concerned?
Well, there is, we're going through a learning period, you know, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he prepared the membership to make the transition
mm-hmm.
from the symbolic teachings, identifying devil as a physical object, a physical person, and identifying God in a physical person. Well, he prepared the community for a smooth transition from that kind of idea, belief,
mm-hmm.
By teaching us that there is coming, he says, someone will teach you religion after me. He told us this.
Mm-hmm.
He said, someone will teach you religion after me. He says, I'm not teaching you religion so much now. He says, what I'm doing is trying to clean you up. And what he meant that he was taking care of the social problems. He was mainly interested in taking care of the social problems. And he had to separate us from the Caucasian people and calling them devils. It was nothing that he invented.
Mm-hmm.
He was a Bible student too. His father was he is the son of his father, who was a Baptist preacher for 50 years.
I see.
And Honorable Elijah Muhammad was very, very well familiar with the Bible from cover to cover. And in the Bible, he used to say that Jesus called the Jew a devil, you know, said, you are the children of your father, the devil, you know. So he spoke from the Bible, and I think he saw something like the Japanese people.
Mm-hmm.
The Japanese people, Chinese people said when the Caucasians, when they were bitterly against the Caucasians, when they would come among them, they would point them out and say, foreign devil.
I see.
Call
yes.
it foreign devil, you know. And I remember reading in a book by, I can't recall the author's name now, is The People Who Walk in Darkness. He uses the words from Julia, a slave. And during the days of plantation slavery,
mm-hmm.
and he uses her words. He says that Julia said that she couldn't understand the white man evil treatment of the black people in slavery. The slave master's evil treatment of the black people. Says they look, speaking of the Caucasian people, says they look. She says they look like God in the face, but they act like the devils in their hearts.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I think the suspicion had already been created. The black people who were mistreated were already suspecting that the white man might be a flesh devil, a living devil in the flesh, you know.
So he took that.
Yeah, he took it, right. He used it, and it was good. And he separated the people. It was good, because at that time, the people who we were dealing with were those who had suffered the most under the Caucasian abuses, you see.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't be mixed with Caucasians. how he wouldn't be able to control his audience if he had those people mix, especially doing the therapeutic job that he did.
Okay, so
bringing out a lot of demons.
There was a period then when he felt he had to isolate.
Certainly,
his
he was
people.
Wise in doing so. Very okay. wise in doing so.
I'm going to ask you about the conflict that is quite widely known between your father and yourself, and how what the nature of it was, and how it was resolved finally, as it was resolved, obviously.
Mm-hmm. The conflict between myself
your father
and my father
and yourself.
Right.
Yes.
Well, there was some conflict, all right, but I think. He was playing the role of a teacher,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes the teacher has to hide certain facts from the student. Looking back on my father's treatment of me, how I rebelled, mm-hmm. and he excommunicated me,
mm-hmm.
and would tell me I could come back. I came back. He would put me in position of minister again. He would set me up before his ministers and point to me as a special person, you know, and he did this several times, excommunicated me and returned me right back to my place of honor.
I see.
So looking back on that, I think the Honorable Elijah Muhammad didn't really disagree with me, but he had to protect what he was doing.
Okay.
It wasn't time.
There's another question concerning leadership that I'd like to ask. In Alex Haley's book on Malcolm X, he states that Malcolm X was assassinated by Muslims,
mm-hmm.
and the implication or statement, as he sees it, is that this assassination took place because of an internal kind of struggle over power.
Mm-hmm.
What explanation is given, if any, to novitiate Muslims, to the person who's just joined the mosque who might be curious about that? How has that gone down in Muslim history?
Yes, well, I sensed among the following that there was sadness, a deep hurt and sadness existing in the membership because Malcolm had been separated from the organization, from the organization, the nation.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt that the people, not only Malcolm needed restoring, but the people needed healing. They needed to be healed,
yes.
Freed from that kind of hurt that was in them, that I noticed in them. So I asked the membership to accept Minister Malcolm back as a minister,
mm-hmm.
of the Nation of Islam,
at
who had done
point
a great
was
work.
This?
This was, I guess, not quite a year after I had come into office.
I see.
Maybe 6 to 7 months after I came into office. And I found that the people were welcome this, and they were very happy. They were very pleased with my decision.
Okay, and the wound is healing, but what about his assassination? Is there any explanation for that?
Well, you know,
I shouldn't say is
the
there
60s,
any, but what is the explanation?
During
that you
the
give?
60s, you know, there was the race conflict so many dangerous elements were involved, mm-hmm. you know, and the people were very fiery and violent prone,
mm-hmm.
even violent prone. And I think that a lot of those members from the, I would say the Black Revolution.
Yes.
Came into the Nation of Islam. The Nation of Islam was a Black Revolution, but of a different, altogether different kind, you know, of a different nature. And I think those persons came in and they didn't have time to learn the teachings.
Mm-hmm.
They just came in identifying with Black supremacy and down with the white man, you know, and they thought that thing was our thing, but it was wrong.
Yes.
And I think perhaps some of those people came in and got the wrong idea, and they were given to violence, so they might have done these acts.
Mm-hmm. I see. You're financially, you are growing. Your resources were 2 years ago well over $30 million in real estate, businesses, mm-hmm. of all sorts. The bakery we know well in the Bay Area anyway is doing a very fine job and mm-hmm. is thriving because it's serving the community well. What plans do you have? You've made a lot of changes. What
yeah.
plans do you have now that you're leader to what plans do you have for the future?
Well, I would say outwardly the business achievements speak very well for the community, and we all are very proud of it.
Mm-hmm.
But we lacked management to equal what was on the outside, you know. I pulled a team of business people together, accountants, certified accountants, and attorneys, etc. I pulled them together, and with the staff, with the ministers, we began to really study the business of the community. Mm-hmm. And we found that the business was poorly managed. Income was being counted as, charity was being counted as business income.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever a business didn't produce, the business couldn't be closed because this would reflect bad on the community. So mm-hmm. what would happen, charities would be put into that business just to keep it going.
I see.
So many of our businesses were looking good because they were really financed or supported by charities.
I see.
So we stopped that.
I see.
And when we stopped that, some businesses had to close. But now we're beginning to move uphill again. We begin to move in the right direction, accomplishing things again for our community in the line of business progress. And we are doing it because we are finding persons who have business qualifications
mm-hmm.
and who really have business minds and want to devote themselves full time to business. We're giving the businesses to those persons if they can afford to buy them. If they can't afford to buy them, we're making easy terms for them.
I see.
Now, and the businesses are available to everybody, but we have applicants from the community, and so far we have been successful in finding people qualified in the community to run these businesses.
And all races and all from whatever
right.
background?
We don't have that many outside of the race
uh-huh.
in the community, but if they make application, they'll get the right
well,
recognition.
That's wonderful.
Too.
I can't tell you how pleased I am that you gave us this time, this exclusive interview. We've run out of time and I have a million more questions, but I have to stop now, so
all
I want
right.
to thank you very, very much,
all
the
right,
Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad, for being with us today. Thank you. I'm Johnny Barnes-Selvin. Good night.